Hello friends, welcome to the last video of 2020. This video was shot on the same day as the previous video about starting with landscape photography, and it was shot with my friend Mike Muizenbelt. And during the day of shooting, Mike has shared a lot of very interesting knowledge about landscape photography, and it was just too much to put into one video. So have fun watching this video. I hope you get some inspiration or some information out of it, and I'll see you guys in the next year. The story starts with me and Mike standing on the shore of the Dutch coastline.
So I'm here with my friend Mikey Mike. Social distancing?
Yep, definitely.
So I was thinking we should record two videos today. One is how to start with landscape photography. And the second one is this one. And we're going to have some fun. We're going to try to fly our drones. And then we're going to talk about long exposure photography as well.
Definitely. We'll try something. The conditions are not too bad. I mean, if it's dry, it's okay. There's some interesting sky behind us, which we can't incorporate in the photo. I'm intrigued now by the poles underneath that building. So I think the first stop is going to be to grab our gear and go towards the poles, see if we can flatten out and create some structures, stuff like that.
And I think maybe it's nice to start with having a look what we have inside our bags.
That's too much today.
Yeah. Let's have a look.
Well, I packed heavy. Apart from the two bottles of water, I've got an ultra wide angle lens with me here. It's the Pentax K1 with the 15-30mm lens. This I want to use if I've got some interesting sky or an interesting foreground to be able to really get into the image. So, extreme wide angle lens. And this one needs its own filters, so I brought Nisi S5 kit with it, and these are the big holders, so these go together. So this is option one, which I can use today, and if I need to get something closer, a 70-200 2.8. so that's one kit. The other kit, it's the normal wide-angle lens that goes on the medium format camera, Pentax 645Z, with a 28-45mm, and that equals about 22-35mm. This is basically the workhorse. The filter kit, these go together, and in here the holder again, and a complete set with all the various filters. So neutral density filters, the gradients, and I'm sure that we'll get into this one a little bit later on. That one goes, if we want to have a little bit more reach, with an 80-160mm zoom. So that's one part. In this bag is the odds and parts, mostly remotes to trigger the cameras. Sometimes I use them, sometimes I just use the 2-second timer on them. Depends on the situation. And if you've watched the last episode that Niels and I did together, I'm sure you're familiar with the GR3. After that session, I really needed one as well. So I picked my own copy. That's in the bag for the quick shots. And of course, again, filters and a filter kit for this one. So basically, I've got three systems with me now. Medium format, full frame, and an APS-C sized format. So, like Niels normally says, let's go.
And as for me, I tried to keep it all in one bag. That was my goal for today. I brought two tripods to make some video shots. And of course, for the landscape photography, I am told that you need a tripod as well. So let's see what I have in the bag. I have also brought a Pentax K1. I bought this and I haven't used it that much, so it's about time for me to start using it. I don't have any filters, so luckily Mike has brought some filters for me. I also have the 70-200, which is this big and heavy bulky thing. I am used to carrying my Ricoh GR3, so this is pretty new for me. Other than that, of course, we are GR shooters, so we have to bring our Ricoh GR3 with the filter set. So for me, it will be very interesting today to see what the different types of images will be coming from the GR or from the K1. I brought my drone as well, the Mavic 2 Pro, to see if we can get some nice aerial shots. And I have got some recording stuff, brought my GoPro, brought some microphones, stuff like that. So that's what we're using today. So we just arrived at the first location on which we are going to try to make some cool shots, and I thought that we were just going to step out on the beach, get our cameras out and shoot away, but Mike's way of approaching things is a little bit different than I expected. So Mike, what the hell is going on, man?
Well, a little while ago we were standing on a dune a little bit further down the beach, and the building that we see behind me, I'll move over here, took my attention because I think it's got nice shapes, it's got lines, and probably we can do something nice with that stuff. And instead of just grabbing my camera and going for it, my personal approach is usually first look, then act. So what I already did, I looked at the building and there's a few things I want to eliminate. There's underneath the building two, what's it called, air conditioning units. And those air conditioning units are not my cup of tea. A little bit further down the building, we also see the pole where the waste comes out from the people who live there. That's not what I want to incorporate in the image. It's raining a little bit, so I'm trying to look for a shot now where I don't need to use my filters. And in this case, it's quite easy because we've got an even sky behind us. The building is dark, so I need to overexpose a bit. And when I'm going to overexpose, I'm losing the detail in the sky just anyway. So what we're going to do, I want to try three different locations and see what those locations bring us.
We are a little bit surprised by how fast the water is rising.
Going lightning fast.
It's going lightning fast. I don't know if you can see it, but there's this small pool right there. I think it's about 50 or 60 centimeters high. And we were like 15 minutes ago, we were just standing there, and now it's almost completely submerged in water. So yeah, that's landscape photography for you. So how's it going, Mike?
It's excellent. I don't see a thing. Now I do again. Water drops gone. No, I'm having a great day. It's the light is good. It's not fantastic, but it's more or less dry. And I'm at the place where I want to be, near the beach, near the water. So what's not to like about today?
And now we're going to change locations, right? We're going to scout another spot.
Yeah, it's high tide now. So there's a flood line now that's dirty and not so interesting. So we're waiting now for the water to recede again. When the water is receding, we'll have a clean beach again without any footsteps, without any rubbish on it. So we'll just see what it brings.
We took a short stop on the way to our next location because we saw two very nice ships along the coastline. So Mike was like, let's stop here for a little bit and see if we can make some nice shots. Of course, you will be able to see them right now. I'm not really sure if I got something. Mike is shooting with the 70-200 and I'm shooting with the 24-70. So it should be nice to have some different focal ranges and to see what different types of images that will produce. Also, we checked the weather and it's not really looking good. It will probably stay like this for a little bit. Little bit of rain, little bit of light and dark parts in the clouds. So that will not really be the ideal circumstances, but that's what we're going to have to make work for today. Did you get anything good?
Did I get anything? Yeah, I don't know if you explained already, but we had some nice contrasts in the sky and a beautiful red ship. So red ship, grays, contrast, opening in the sky with some light in it. So I think that's going to be a shot which I'll process today.
Red ship, he said, not red shit.
Red shit.
Red shit. We are shooting shits, ships right now.
The GR.
How you like your GR?
I love the resolution of the GR. It's like quality in a very small package.
It's
so
crazy,
I like it.
Right?
Yeah, it's sometimes you think, why am I lugging the backpack? But if you don't have got it, and if you've got the GR in your pocket, it works instantly. And
yeah,
of course, I like the menu structure because I'm working with them already so long. So I can really quickly change. But most impressed still when I open it back home on the big screen, I think, man, that much resolution, that much dynamic range in a package that's so small. They really did a great job with it.
Of course, you shouldn't believe anything we say about either Pentax or Ricoh, because we are,
biased.
A little bit
We're
influenced.
Slightly biased.
Slightly biased, but try it for yourself and you will see. Right?
Yeah. you can always ask raw files with Niels.
And Mike, what's that over there in the sky?
What's that in the sky? It's natural light.
What's that, man? Natural light?
We actually have got some natural light. I don't know. We may get some shadows that we need to take into account.
Oh man.
When making a composition.
This video took an unexpected turn of events.
We're on our way for, I think, an hour or four, something like that.
Hell yeah.
And that's the first sunshine we see.
Yep.
Damn. We're here at the beach now. And both Niels and I are getting really excited because of what we're seeing here. It's low tide. We've got some nice, wet stretches of beach. The poles, which are unique for the beach we're going to today, are becoming visible because they were a few hours ago, they were all covered in water. And this is not luck, this is planning. And we planned this day because we knew that today the water was receding during sunset. And sun is setting, I think, in 1.5 hours from now. So we've got 1.5 hours to work with, hopefully, a lot of nice structures here on the beach. And I've got a few apps on my desktop at home and on my telephone, of course. One of them is tides. I really pay a lot of attention to what tides are doing because I don't like to work on the beach when the water is coming towards me. I always like the water to go away from me. And the same, of course, sunset is important. You want to know if there's rain in the forecast. You want to know if there's a chance of scattered clouds, which I like a lot. In the weather wise, so as a landscape photographer, you're always checking the weather and the conditions in the area that you want to go to. My thoughts about filters, because everything I've been saying today, of course, are my thoughts, my experiences. They may vary if you ask other photographers, but why do I personally use filters? First of all, because there are some effects that I cannot create in Photoshop. If we want to have a long exposure, I either need to have very dark circumstances or I need something to block the light, and in that case the ND filter comes into play. Just for the people who don't know what an ND filter looks like, this is just the dark glasses, and this one is a 6-stop filter, so it reduces the light by 6 stops. You've got them stronger. This one is a 10-stop, and a 10-stop can be used during daylight. My personal favorite, 6-stop. But the main reason why I create it, because I want to create motion blur. I want to get rid of texture in the ocean. You can blur a waterfall with it. So that's one reason. The other filter that I really like to use is the polarizer filter. And the polarizer filter adds contrast, gets rid of certain reflections. So the polarizer is actually always in place, and if I remove this one you can see it more clearly, I think. It's the one that's currently in front of my camera over here, and it's screwed into the holder. The holder goes on the lens, and the lens has got various step up or step down rings, and this one goes from 82 millimeters, well, all the way down to, let's say, 52 millimeters. So you can use the kit on any lens that you've got. And by turning the wheels, you either, I always say, you put the polarizer on or off. If you put a polarizer on, you will see that there's more structure in the clouds, the sky becomes more blue, and either reflection in the foreground, well, they either appear or disappear, one of the two. Then there's a third one, which you could do in Photoshop also, or in post-processing, that is the graduated filter. And the graduated filter you use because your dynamic range of the sensor isn't big enough to capture all the information. If you got something like the texture on my coat at the moment, which is very dark, in combination with a sky that is light, it won't fit on the dynamic range of your camera. So then you take a graduated filter and you block part of the sky to make sure that the dynamic range or the scene fits on the dynamic range of your camera. But you could always also take, of course, one proper exposure for your foreground and a second exposure to balance out the sky and put them together in Photoshop. So basically three types, polarizer, the ND filter, and the graduated ND filter. Two of them you need in the field, one you could opt afterwards. But on the other hand, I like the sport of doing everything in the field also. I'm just thinking that I see a ship approaching, and I'm always trying to visualize images before I make them, and the image I'm visualizing now, but I don't think I can work fast enough, is that I'm standing between the row of poles looking in towards the ocean, and then do a long shutter speed of about 6-7 seconds that you still see that there's a ship floating by, but it more becomes of a blur. So you get some interesting stuff in the background.
You want to make it a challenge?
The 10-second challenge. filters, but then we go back, because then I've got more time.
And here I was thinking landscape photography was all about thinking and peace and quiet and taking your time to really plan your shots. And here Mike is running across the beach trying to catch a moving ship. I think you have got about a minute left, Mike. Come on, Mike.
Left.
Make it happen. Make me proud, brother.
This is 10.
The ship is approaching, Mike.
This is 6. Coming. Now. It's a bit too long.
Well, you get the shot.
This was 6 seconds, but yeah. We'll see at home what we make of it.
Well, you did get the shot, so I'm kind of proud of you, man. Over the last few videos, I have been introducing my mostly English audience to a Dutch word of the day. Can you maybe introduce us to a new Dutch word of the day you would like to teach our
on the spot,
the nice people viewing? Yeah.
On the spot.
On the spot.
Damn, no, I can't. I'll think of one.
Okay.
A Dutch word. No, give me 3 minutes, which I'll try to come up with a Dutch word which describes the day.
Oh, okay,
that's
okay.
Nice.
Yeah.
But let me reflect, and I'll
all
be
right,
back.
All right, no problem. So I have heard, about 5 minutes has gone by since, that we have a Dutch word of the day.
Yes, I found one, which describes the day perfectly. It's waanzinnig.
What does it mean, man?
Waanzinnig.
Waanzinnig.
It's what we've got here. It's like, I've got structure, I've got light, I've got contrast, I've got a composition which I'm fairly happy with. I've got some foam in the ocean. It's waanzinnig.
Waanzinnig.
It's like madness in a good way.
Crazy good.
Crazy good.
Three thumbs
That's
up.
The one.
Right? Yeah.
And that concludes the last video of 2020. It has been a crazy year with both ups and downs. And I'm excited to see what the next year will bring. One of the things I have not been happy with is my inconsistency in making videos, and I'm planning to do better in the next year. Thank you for sticking around. You can expect more videos, more fun adventures, and more photography related content from me in the next year. If you aren't already subscribed to this YouTube channel, please consider doing so. It would be much appreciated. Do not forget to have fun with photography, enjoy the process of learning new stuff, and just stay positive. I will see you in the next year.
So there you have it, guys, a nice little video about long exposures and landscape photography in general. Mike, for me, is one of those guys who you look up to, who is a very big source of not only inspiration but also knowledge. So thank you for having me, Mike.
My pleasure. I mean, it's the second time we're out together, and you can ring me up any day. Yeah. I'll tag along.
Always good time.
And we'll have a great day.
Yeah. So thank you guys for watching. I hope this video can be a little bit of value for you, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Peace.
What triggers your attention, then?
Well, you told me. Nice reflection right here.